One of these ladies is a housewife who recently made international headlines. What is your name, please?
My name is Jerrie Mock.
My name is Jerrie Mock.
My name is Jerrie Mock.
Only one of these ladies is the real Jerrie Mock. The other two are imposters and will try to fool this panel. Tom Poston, Peggy Cass, Orson Bean, and Kitty Carlisle. On to Tell the Truth with your host, Bud Collyer.
Thank you very much. Thank you, and welcome once again to Tell the Truth. Brought to you this week by the makers of Easy Off Oven Cleaner, the easy way to make dirtiest ovens sparkle like new. Easy Off Oven Cleaner.
Good evening, panel.
Good evening, Bud.
Man, what a greeting that was. That was worth everything.
How good I could eat a jar of Easy Off.
Turn it right over to you after the show. Please open your envelope and follow along, if you will, as I read. I, Jerrie Mock, am a wife and mother. Recently, I took a month's vacation from my husband and three children. Alone in our 11-year-old family airplane, I flew some 23,000 miles. In so doing, I became the first woman in history to fly an airplane completely around the world. Signed, Jerrie Mock. Three ladies all claim to be Jerrie Mock, first woman to fly around the world. And we start this questioning with Kitty Carlisle. Kitty?
Thank you, Bud. Now I know why I couldn't get Jerrie Mock on my daytime show. Number three, how long did this trip take you?
A little over 29 days.
Number two, what did you carry in the car? What costume did you wear in the cockpit of this plane?
I wore dresses.
Only?
Only.
Number one, where did you stop?
Which time?
How many times did you stop?
21.
Oh, you stopped every day?
Oh, glory, no.
Oh.
It would have been
well, it took 29 days, you stopped 21 times.
Well, I had to lay over at different points.
Uh-huh. Number two, did you ever run out of fuel? Did I read something about you having
no,
fuel?
No, I didn't.
No.
Oh, no.
Tom Poston.
I hope not. Miss Mock, number two, or Mrs. Mock, I guess it is, isn't it, number two?
Yes, it is.
Mrs. Mock, who is attempting to fly Amelia Earhart's flight pattern when she was lost to the world?
Joan Miriam Smith.
Yeah, I believe that's right. Number three, do you know the most dangerous leg of that journey? She recently took off on the most dangerous leg of that journey. Do you remember which one it was? Would you have any idea?
Which number?
No,
number three.
I don't consider any of them dangerous.
Not of your flight. I mean of Miss Smith, Mrs. Smith's flight.
In following.
I wouldn't know, no.
You wouldn't know. Number one. Oh, thank you.
Peggy Cass.
Number two, wonderful. What kind of an aircraft do you have that's 11 years old?
A Cessna 180.
Number one, did you have any breakdowns? Not that I mean to knock the Cessna,
not
but
a breakdown. Is
no
that,
breakdown.
No.
But number three, since you had a long layovers, why did you lay over so long?
Well, I had to spend 6 days in Bermuda because the weather was bad.
Oh, thank you. Number one, did you go to New Zealand?
No.
Number two, did you go to Arabia?
Yes, I did.
Number three, where did you land in Arabia?
Dahran.
Where?
Dahran.
Oh, I know it well. Number one, did you fly over the Pacific?
Yeah, sure.
And where did you land?
In the Pacific?
Yes, not in the Pacific, surely.
She means in that flight.
Oh, three spots.
Orson Bean.
Number two, I've heard that in Arabia, which takes in a great many countries, there are sheiks and potentates and nawabs who are only too anxious to get their hands on a nice American lady who lands all alone on a plane. How did you fend them off? I mean, a nice-looking lady like you. Did you have any of that trouble?
They kept waiting for a man to get out of the plane.
Oh, did they? Well, Chacon à son goût. Number two. Number three, I mean. Now, you left your husband alone for 29 days. What did he do? I mean, who cleaned up the house and all? Who cooked for the kids?
His mother came and stayed there.
His mother?
I don't know if I'm glad or sorry to have to call time on this one, but in any event, time. There's no more questions, but it is time for you now to mark your ballots. Will you kindly vote at once with no consultation whatsoever? Simply vote now for number one, number two, or number three. The team of challengers will receive $250, of course, for every incorrect vote. All ballots marked, panel? All right, Tom, for whom did you vote?
I voted for number two because I think if Kitty had had a chance to ask any questions, we would have found out a lot. I'm sorry that Kitty didn't get her turn.
She did get her turn.
Oh, did she? Oh, I must have had another reason.
Peggy Cass.
Well, I voted for number one because she said she stopped three times in the Pacific. And I once went across the Pacific, and it took me 29 days just to get across there. So I figured in a plane, you'd have to stop at least three.
You didn't have a plane?
No, I was on a boat.
Oh.
A man on a boat.
And Shekhar Bean.
Well, I don't really have a clue, except that I voted for number three because she has a kind of a pretty all-American looks, and I think that when they make the film, Doris Day will play her part, and she reminds me of...
Well, there we have one, two, and three. With which are you casting your lot, Kitty?
I'm with three, because I think they were all absolutely marvelous, but number three said that she stayed over in Bermuda 6 days, and she's the only one that's got a suntan.
Oh. All right, there we have a widely split vote to start things off this evening. Let's go for the truth and find out how close to it is, or they are, I should say, as we learn now which of these young ladies actually did just become the first woman to fly a plane around the world. Will the real Jerrie Mock please stand up? Thank you very much, and our congratulations to you, Jerrie.
But it did rain in Bermuda. I didn't get a bit of suntan there.
Really?
It's a marvelous achievement, and we're all terribly proud, and thank you
sure
for doing it.
And thank God on behalf of your family that you got through it safely. That's thank the important you. Part. Number one, what is your real name, and what do you really do?
My name is Lynn Knight, and I'm Reuben H. Donnelly, telephone directory representative for the Yellow Pages.
Ah! Thank you. And number two, what is your real name and what do you do?
My name is Mildred Whitlock. I am director of hospital volunteers at Touro Infirmary, New Orleans, Louisiana.
You just happen to be from Kitty's hometown, that's all. They're very proud of her down there. We're mighty proud of her here. It's a constant fight as to who'll keep her, but we're winning so far. Thank heaven. Well, in checking the score, ladies, we find that there were two incorrect votes, and those are the ones you are most interested in. And at $250 each, that's $500 from Easy Off, as well as a carton of the fine products from the makers of Easy Off. Thank you very much. I hope you found this a happy experience, because we thoroughly enjoyed having you here. Good night, and God bless you. And now let's meet our next team of challengers.
What is your name, please?
My name is David Cornwell.
My name is David Cornwell.
My name is David Cornwell.
Once again, panel, will you follow along as I read? I, David Cornwell, am a former Eton schoolmaster and former member of the British Foreign Service. I am also the author of three novels, two of which caused practically no comment, and one which became an instantaneous success and to date has sold nearly 250,000 copies. The book is at the top of the American bestseller lists and will be made into a movie later this year. That master of suspense, Graham Greene, calls it the best spy story he ever read. I wrote it under the pen name John le Carré. It is called The Spy Who Came In From the Cold. Signed, John le Carré. These three gentlemen, as you heard me say, all claim to be, as you heard them say, John le Carré, the author of The Spy Who Came In From the Cold, an American bestseller. We'll start the cross-examination with Peggy Cass. Peggy?
Thank you, but I read the book and it's peachy. I was really crazy about it. Now, number one, who's David Benedictus?
He is
Somebody who wrote a book about Eton.
Number three, who is Smiley?
George Smiley is the hero of the first two novels who appears very briefly in The Spy.
Number two, what are the names of your first two novels?
Call for the Dead and A Murder of Quality.
Thank you. Number three, what happens on the 4th of June?
That is a celebration day at Eton.
Number one, what is the name of the hero of The Spy Who Came In From the Cold?
Alec Lemus.
And number...
Orson Bean.
Yes. Number one, who is Dr. Grimsby Roylott of Stokes Moran?
No idea. Yes, I do know. He appears in The Speckled Band.
Quite right, by Sherlock Holmes or whoever that fellow is. number two, who is Irving Winespar? Don't know, huh?
I couldn't tell you.
Number three, who published your book?
Where, here or in England?
Here.
Coward McCann.
Coward McCann. And it's about a war, is it, number three, still? Does it take place during a war?
The Spy?
Yes.
I assume you haven't read it then.
I haven't read it, no.
It's
I haven't read anything since Stealthy Steve and the Great Blue Diamond that pertains to...
It's about the Cold War.
The Cold War. Oh, so it's a modern day. No,
yes.
I see.
Kitty Carlisle.
Number one, who's making the movie?
Paramount.
Who bought it?
Paramount.
Do you know who's going to be in it, number two?
Yes, who? Bert Lancaster is being cast as Alec Lemus.
Number three, who is your publisher in England?
Victor Gallant.
Victor Gallant?
Yes.
Is that your publisher, number one?
Yes.
Ah, well, that generally doesn't happen that way. Number two, why did you choose the name Le Carré as your nom de plume?
Well, it has a connotation in, literally in English, of being the square, which I found amusing.
Oh, that's very good.
Tom Poston.
Thank you. Number two, which side of the river is Eton on?
When you say which side of the river, I don't know which side you're referring to. There are two sides.
Well, would you say facing downstream, it's on the left or the right? How's that?
Facing downstream, it's on the right.
Thank you. Number three, where is Bray? Where is Bray Studios? Where's Bray?
Bray is it's in Surrey. It's north of Windsor.
I'm confused myself now. Number one, do you know what Monkey Island is?
Yes, it's an island in the River Thames, and it has a hotel on it.
Which way is that from Eton, do you know?
I think it's north.
Thank you. And that's all the time we have. It's time for you now to mark your ballot. So mark them, panel, happily and firmly. Mark them for the one you think is the real one without any consultation whatsoever, of course. Merely vote now for number one, number two, or number three. Everyone voted? All right, Tom, for whom did you vote?
I just voted against number two because it's on the left side when you face downstream. But anyway, the other two guys knew too much.
Peggy.
I just voted for number three.
Well, I voted for number three. They all knew everything, but I thought he gave his answers sort of very tersely, as if you were in the Secret Service. That didn't tell us too much.
Orson Bean.
Well, number two didn't know who Irving Winespar is. And number one has the twinkle in his eye that most writers don't have. Number three looks like the kind of a guy that can sit down in a den and yell at the wife to keep her out and go to work and type all day. And so I voted for him. He's a writer type.
Kitty, making it unanimous.
I voted for number three for very specific reasons. When he said that Orson hadn't read his book, he spoke with the asperity of authors whose books have not been read. There was a touch of real malice.
Very well, it's unanimous. You haven't done that in quite a while. Let's see whether it takes you unanimously to success or to failure. As we learn now, which one of these gentlemen actually did write a bestseller about to be made into a movie, a spy thriller known as The Spy Who Came In From the Cold? Will the real John le Carré please stand up?
I can...
Well, it was worth worth all the study and everything else, wasn't it? A very, very good job. Number two, what is your real name and what do you really do?
My name is James Marshall, and I'm manager of Minton Auto Leasing.
And number three, you got all the votes with the twinkle in your eye. What is your real name and what do you really do?
My name is Peter Hodgkins, and I'm an executive of the Central American Iron and Steel Company.
Well, it was a beautiful job of fooling all the way down the line. Believe me, gentlemen, and our congratulations to you on the success of your book, sir, and great continued success with the movie. We shall all be waiting to see it. Checking the score, it's a simple thing. You can check it yourself. There were four incorrect, and that times $250 makes $1,000 from Easy Off coming your way, as well as a gift package of all the fine products from the makers of Easy Off. And our sincere thanks to you, gentlemen. Hope you had as much fun as you brought to us. Good night. Bless you. Now a word about a fine product. And now let's meet our third team of challengers.
What is your name, please?
My name is Joe Piro.
My name is Joe Piro.
My name is Joe Piro.
Follow along with this story, if you will, as I read from my copy panel. I, Joe Piro, have been teaching ballroom dancing for 17 years. In that time, I estimate I have taught over 500,000 pupils, including many notables such as Shirley Booth, Arthur Schlesinger, Margot Fonteyn, Eva Gabor, and the Duke and Duchess of Windsor. I am responsible for introducing into the United States both the Mambo and the Pachanga. I am also expert in the intricacies of dances like the Watusi, the Surf, the Hitchhike, the Wobble, the Mashed Potato, the Chicken Back, and the Frug. My students and friends all call me Killer Joe, signed Joe Piro. Very well, panel. These three gentlemen all claim to be Killer Joe Piro. We'll start with Tom Poston, if we may, Tom.
Bud, if it's who I'm thinking it is, only he would have the nerve to teach dancing to Dame Margot Fonteyn. I'm sure I know this fella, so I'd better disqualify myself before we go any farther.
Oh, okay, Tom. Fair enough. That brings us up to you, Peggy. Suppose you start us off with the question.
You know, it's so humiliating. I don't know how to do one of these dances. Not one. May I ask you, number three, is the mashed potato hard to do?
No, it's simple to do.
Is the chicken back anything like the Madison?
No, it's a little busier.
Busier? Boy, the Madison's too busy for me. May I ask you, number two, what do you do when you do the frug? You do it alone?
You can do it alone, or you do it with a partner.
Number three, in the surf, do you touch the person you're dancing with, or do you stand away from them?
No, you stand away from your partner.
Now, number one, what service were you in when you were in the service, if you were in the service?
I was in the Navy.
You're in the Navy?
In the Navy.
Number three, didn't you become famous at a certain place?
Yes.
Where was the place, number one?
Orson Bean.
Number one, is it frug or is it frug?
Well, it's carefully pronounced either way.
Oh, I see. All right. Number two, esoterically speaking, what is the difference between the chicken back and the frug, in your own words?
Well, basically, they're the same. But in the chicken back, you're sort of shaking your behind a little bit.
And in the frug,
You're more or less stationary.
Stationary, I see. Number...
You don't get so far behind.
I see. Number one, what is the dance where a group in a line does it?
Oh, that's the Hully Gully.
Hully Gully. And number three, is there another dance where a group in a line does it?
Madison.
Number three, why is it that you always see two girls dancing these things together and you never see two guys? I mean, really, you know, if I wanted to ask Tom out tonight, we'd know...
Kitty Carlisle,
but you always want to leave.
Number three, what is that dance that comes from Haiti where you walk like you have a wooden leg, so this way?
Merengue.
The merengue. Number two, how tall is Arthur Schlesinger?
He's about 5'5".
Number one, How? What did you teach Margot Fonteyn?
At my studio.
But what did you teach her to do?
Oh, I'm sorry, I misunderstood. Well, she wanted to know the twist and various other modern steps to take back with her.
Uh-huh. Was she a good ballroom dancer?
One lesson, and she had the whole thing, just like that.
Number two. Well, I don't know how to do any of these dances either, so all I can do is kind of laugh, you know, the wrong side of my face. Which one do you think is the easiest if I wanted to pick up one of these quickly?
I would say the frug.
The frug?
Yes.
Which you do alone?
Yes.
Thanks a lot.
Time for, no more time for questions. It's time for dancing now. So dance lightly on your ballots and leave your marks, if you will, please. Mark them at once without change, no consultation. Vote now for number one, number two, or number three. All the ballots marked. Have you marked yours, Orson?
No, I haven't.
Will you please?
Oh, mercy.
You can lead. Just mark. All right, Tom, for whom did you vote this time?
Well, I had to disqualify myself. I don't get a vote,
oh, that's
so I
right,
thought
I'd
put in a plug for our producers.
All right, then. Peggy.
Well, I voted for number three. You know, he just looks to me as though he'd be a swell dancer. Just sitting there, I can tell he's got a natural sense of rhythm, so I voted for three.
All right, Orson.
Yes, I think number three. Number three reminds me of George Raft, who was one of the great ballroom dancers of all time. And one time somebody said about George Raft, when he gets all dressed up, George Raft looks like a stolen car. I don't know why I thought of that, but anyway.
Funny. Marvelous.
All right. Kitty, that brings it down to you.
I voted for number three.
Oh, gee.
Wow.
Well, I think they're all marvelous, but I kind of felt that number three was the one that would have the sobriquet Killer Joe, and also I'd like to have a dance with him.
Maybe we can arrange that. So it's almost unanimous, and of course, regardless of how the vote goes, Tom's vote goes as an incorrect vote because of a disqualification through knowing the one who it really is. So let's go down the line with these votes and see how close they are to the truth. Learning now which of these gentlemen actually is known as Killer Joe and is the real dance teacher of note. So will the real Killer Joe Piro please stand up? Thank you very much. Was that the one that you knew?
Oh,
you knew?
Sure, I've known Joe since, I don't know how long, years and years.
Well, Joe has graciously consented to show us a few of his steps before we start them, though. Kitty, do you want to do them with him?
Or... Yes, yeah, right. I need my lessons first.
All right. Joe, would you please take over?
We have a little French twist. Of course, all the rooms are small. Here's the Italian twist.
We're having a party.
And right here in America,
dancing
American twist.
To the music.
Now the fruit.
Played by the DJ. On the radio.
Monkey is very easy.
The cooks are in the
use the hands
box.
A little bit.
Popcorn on the table.
Hitchhiker.
Me and my
and here's the chicken back.
Mr. DJ,
play and wobble.
Keep those records
playing. Popeye.
Cause I'm having such a good time.
Thank you very much, Joe. All right, let's find out about your two sidekicks. Now, number one, what is your real name, sir, and what do you really do?
Well, I'm Bobby Lloyd, and I'm a TV announcer at WHEC-TV in Rochester, New York.
Ah, nice to have you with us. And number two, what is your real name, and what do you do, sir?
My name is Jules Field, and I'm the co-owner of the Gaslight Clubs.
Well, in checking the score, there was only one incorrect vote, but that's $250 coming your way, gentlemen, to be divided. That's because of the... disqualification of Tom Poston, and of course that comes to you from Easy Off as well as a gift package of all of the fine products and the makers of Easy Off. Thank you very much for being with us, and Joe, keep us posted on how Kitty is getting along from time
Bye.
To time. Good night and God bless you. That's all we have time for tonight. Good night, panel, and thank you for being you. Good night to all of you. Don't forget to join us again next week at the same time. And, of course, I'll see you tomorrow afternoon on the daytime show. In the meantime, speaking for Easy Off, may I remind you once again to tell the truth. Good night, everybody.
To Tell the Truth is a Mark Goodson, Bill Todman production. Has been brought to you by Concentrated Heat Liquid, the liniment to relieve minor rheumatism, arthritis, or backache pain per hour. Johnny Olson speaking. For To Tell the Truth, Miss Carlisle's gown by Go Save, the program recorded.